currently.
Thank you. Go ahead.
I'll share my experience. I left my job just over 2 years back in London to come back to India and set up a consumer dairy products venture. Realizing fully well that getting funding for it and setting it up is going to be challenging. But I never estimated the intensity of the challenge. It took me about 18 months to raise the $5 million that I needed to get started. I finally did that, but it took me 18 months to do that. And certainly an eye-opener in terms of the intensity and scale of the challenge in terms of raising funding for ventures like mine. So my view on this is that there are a few points. One is that this missing impact investor is actually a subset of a larger issue of a missing early stage startup investor in India. That ecosystem is, quite frankly, pretty non-existent. There are certain sectors where there is early stage funding which is available, but for much of the larger sectors, take agri-foods and things like that, which are huge businesses in India. You take dairy, for example, the $40 billion category. But investor understanding of these sort of sectors and early stage investments here is absolutely missing. So this impact investor issue is actually a subset of the early stage ecosystem not having developed to the extent so far. I think the other issue is like it has been sort of already spoken about, there are these NGOs and there are these full-scale commercial ventures. My venture is also a full-scale commercial venture, and I've never pitched it as a social venture. But social impact is very much part of it. Without the farmers, the thousands of farmers being part of it who are, in the supply chain, my venture doesn't work. And obviously, because we are there, they benefit out of being, having access to our markets and things like that. So, but it's not about being a social venture. It's moved beyond that, wherein it's more about conscious capitalism. We've got a venture which is absolutely commercial, absolutely capitalist in its orientation, but we've got a clear thinking to ensure that we can do our small things like having direct connectivity with the farmers instead of going the easier route of having agents in between. So those things have moved on, and with this sort of approach, scale and returns, all these things are absolutely possible. And I think there is a bit of disconnect between investors who either look at things as NGOs or fully commercial ventures, and I guess that will also evolve over time. The other point was, it's not just about the equity investor, it's also about the debt provider. What was kind of astonishing was that there's so much talk at the government level about banks having priority sectors and things like that, and as like falls right over there in terms of being in the priority sector. But I realized that banks couldn't lend to us because we were not farmers ourselves. So this was again quite shocking. So my commercial debt is absolutely on commercial terms, like any other venture, and the missing link there is that there has to be some kind of reform in terms of banking regulations, so that debt to ventures like Milk Mantra is made available with slightly preferential terms, because the government wants to do this. The government wants to build manufacturing units, processing units in the food sector across rural India. But then, you have to do it at a scale, and to do that, you need to, provide debt to ventures like ours at slightly preferential terms. And if that happens, that will actually also, attract equity investors further, to come into the these sort of ventures as well. So, several issues kind of interlinked, which are complex. And the fact is that this investor is very much missing today.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. See, I'm from Avishkar, so let me give you a, I mean, just to link up with what Sasha said and what Sri said, just the trend that I've seen being here over the last 9-10 years, the profile of the entrepreneur that we used to see in 2002-03 time frame is very different from the profile of the entrepreneur that we see today. And it's something that we discuss internally in the team as well, to, and which probably is an indicator of where the impact investing phenomenon is heading to, I guess, because in 2002, maybe some of our companies are here, but I mean, I think the, so I hope they understand what I'm trying to say. In those early days, when we looked at companies, it used to be, at least we used to feel, or rather we feel today in hindsight, that there were entrepreneurs who were trying to do, nice people trying to do a nice job. So that is classical social. And then we internally defined a stage two, who said nice people who want to do something big, but they don't know how to do it big. That is stage two. And we believe that we are in a stage three, or like what Sasha said, maybe we are in version 2.0, where, and also linking with what Sri Kumar said, that there are nice people in terms of what their intention is, but they really want to build big businesses. In terms of really not putting themselves into the cage that we are a social, so we are a little different from somebody else, that is not the sentiment that we see in some of the people who are coming in today, which I think is the right way to go, because taking from where Sri Kumar just mentioned, we believe that an entrepreneur is an entrepreneur, period. There is no social entrepreneur. This whole word of social entrepreneur itself might be, there is no such thing as a social entrepreneur. An entrepreneur is an entrepreneur. I mean, he just wants to really do his business, and which I believe that even if you talk to any entrepreneur, that's what they would tell you. The word social impact is something that we have put defined on it based on what we want to see and based on what we believe we want to see, etc. And keeping this whole trend in mind, my belief is that the phase three kind of people that we were just talking about, the people who want to build big businesses and who really want to get into that real big stage, I think they would create role models. I think one of the important reasons, which I think in my mind, the reason why the impact investment climate in terms of a third party investor looking at opportunities in this space has not probably happened, is because possibly they haven't seen these businesses really grow to a scale and size and make a lot of money, and therefore really mix and merge this idea of doing good and doing it good and doing it big and doing it correctly. So this kind of us, so there are a lot of people who are doing good, but they are small. But there are guys who we believe, like Sri Kumar, who can do it nice, but can also do it very big. I think that kind of a transition will happen. And if there are more people who are doing something like that, I believe will create a much more favorable reaction in terms of the investor community. And I agree with you that I think, whether you're early stage itself has got the same kind of risks as compared to all early stage businesses inherently, we believe, is social. I mean, if you look at early stage businesses, if you're targeting in India, especially in a country like India, whatever you might be doing, you might be employing 10 people, or at least you might be employing, you might be doing some better product. So in that sense, it's difficult to call it as not being, making an impact to the surrounding society. I think it's the fact about these businesses, how they transform and become big and become multi-billion dollar businesses and create a model for others to follow, I think would be key to get this more institutional approach to impact investing going. I think so.
Great. Actually, it was nice to hear words there. One thing I'd really like to start off by saying is not many entrepreneurs understand where investors are coming from and what an investor's imperatives are. You must realize that in many of our cases, we don't manage just our own money, but we have LPs who give us money to manage. And so if we run a fund, as Sasha runs a fund, and if them, I do want to start by saying, you know, the missing impact investors, we're all here, I mean, all over the room. I think there are 2-3 of us on stage itself. If you can see us, we're here. The key thing to understand is that our investors give us money, they expect a return back from us in 8 years, 10 years, 7 years. So we have internally, to make the model work, we have to return 2 to 3.5 or 4 times the money that we were given 8 years before. For that to work, out of every 10 companies, you know, 1 or 2 have to be 10x, 15x super hits. 2 or 3 will die. Two or three will give us 2x, 3x, and 2 or 3x will not be exitable. You know, that kind of mix is going to allow us to give a, you know, 20%, 22%, 25% IRR, which then gets the money back. With that being the consideration, I really, you know, will support what he was saying, which is, for us, an enterprise, the more important part is it's an enterprise before it's, you know, whether it's social or not. Yes, there's probably a layer. Yesterday, I was judging some startups here at the Sankalp thing. The first layer is this, does it have social impact or not? But once you get past that, every consideration has to be financial at that point. You must realize that for us to be able to invest money, we have to have a chance of getting money back so that we can put it back in the ecosystem. If you don't get money back, you'll get money from us, you'll never get money from us again, the sector will die. So you must really understand that you have to work within these rules of investing. I've seen, and probably you know, some of us can back this up, personally I've got maybe 28 investments, and in the fund that I run currently we have 14 investments, including what, you know, undoubtedly what you'd call social investments. We have a co-investment in Avishkar, in a company called Vatsalya, which runs a dozen or a couple of dozen hospitals in rural India, and a few others like that. We help sell 3 lakh bus tickets a month, you know, intercity bus routes. I think the thing that really makes it work is to understand it's an enterprise, that it requires return. What I think I'd like to see from the entrepreneurs is, and what I'm happy to see less of compared to a few years ago, is a sense of entitlement. I mean, many entrepreneurs come up and say, look, I'm social, give me money. Well, you know what, you know, you might be social and that's all, very, you might be a great guy, but you know, for to be able to get money, you have to allow us to make an investment that allows us to recoup the investment at enough of a multiple for us to pour money back into the system and for it to make sense to everybody. So I think the sense of entitlement, I'm doing good, why aren't you giving me money, just can't be there. The second is the sense of realism about the levels of investment. If you look at it on a purchasing power basis, we're probably, you know, 1/4 of what's there in the US. Early stage in the US is probably $5 to $10 million. Hence, early stage in India is $1 to $2 million. So hence, if you're saying $5 million for an early stage, I think you're extraordinarily lucky you got it. And you're extraordinarily lucky you got it in only 18 months, right? Most people wouldn't even get it in that amount of time. A typical early stage investment, you know, you should look at up to a year to raise the investment, and the fact that it'll get you about $1 million to $2 million before you break even on a cash flow basis, and then you get growth investment. Those are the numbers at which, and the scales at which things work in India. And yes, compared to 10 years ago, I think there were just a hand, you know, a couple of us then. It's good to see the Bombay Angels and Indian Angels and, you know, a couple of other early stage funds that are there. And I'm really hopeful. I mean, we're here because we want to make an impact. Please do understand, an early stage fund by definition is a social fund. All of us have the ability to manage $500,000, $500 million. The fact that we've chosen to manage only $50 million is not so much a reflection on our ability, it's a reflection on our choice not to make 10 times our own management fees, but to instead take a lower management fee and try to make that amount of impact and hopefully make a little up for it in the kind of multiples we get out here. So anybody who's really working at a fund size of less than 100 million is doing some sort of, you know, goodness to give something back, because you know that you can't really do a lot of good when you're managing a $1 billion fund, because you can only invest, you know, 50 million at a time. But all the investors who are making small size investments can easily make larger investments and choose to make smaller size investments, because I think somewhere in their own mentality is the reason that they want to make an impact and they want to make a change in the world at that lower end of the pyramid.